Thank you. Martina, could you please call the roll to ensure that we have a quorum of the board present?
Absolutely, President McMillan. And I did just want to go ahead and announce that Director Mark White is participating remotely as permitted by the Brown Act and amended by AB 2449. Director White is attending remotely due to a contagious illness. Director White, can you let us know if there are any adults present with you who are over the age of 18?
There are none.
Perfect. And now proceeding with roll. Director Molesworth for Bolinas.
Here.
Director Burke, Mill Valley.
Here.
Director Kurtz is absent for this meeting. Director Paulson for Larkspur.
Here.
Director Rodoni for the County of Marin.
Present.
Director Donahue for Inverness.
Here.
Director Evergettis for Kentfield.
Present.
Director Shea for Marin Wood.
Present.
Director Murray for Muir Beach. Director Goings for Novato.
Here.
Director Finn for Sleepy Hollow.
Here.
Director Hilliard for Southern Marin Fire.
Here.
Director White is attending remotely. Director Casisa for the town of Corte Madera.
Here.
Director Kohler for Fairfax.
Here.
Director Feynman for San Anselmo.
Here.
And President McMillan.
Here.
And I did just want to remind the directors in the room that the outside and virtual audience cannot hear you unless you press the button on your microphone. When the light turns green, you are live. When you're not speaking and the light's red, you are not on a hot mic.
Thank you, Martina. Number three, agenda adjustments. Do board members or staff have any adjustments to the agenda? Seeing none. Number four, open time for public expression. The public is welcome to address the board of directors at this time on matters not on the agenda that are within the jurisdiction of the board. Please be advised that pursuant to Government Code Section 54954.2, the board is not permitted to discuss or take action on any matter not on the agenda. Comments may be no longer than 3 minutes and should be respectful to the community. Please silence your cell phones during the meeting and mute your microphone when not reporting out. Martina, public comment.
If there are any members of the public who wish to speak during the open time for public expression, please raise your hand in the reactions. And for those joining us by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand and *6 to unmute yourself. And Madam President, there are no hands for public comment.
Thank you. Number five, Executive Officer's Report. Executive Officer Mark Brown will provide the staff report on this item.
Good afternoon, President McMillan, board members. Great to see you all here. Let me appropriately share my screen. You would think after all this time, I would have had it figured out by now, but not so much. Even practice it before we started the meeting. There we go. Just wanted to acknowledge that this is Hispanic Heritage Month. So September 15th through October 15th, obviously a very important month for those of us in California since, we used to be Mexico. But anyway. All right. So I know everyone is very pleased with the fire season that we've had so far, not an aggressive fire season. Acreage is down. Ignitions are down. We've been fortunate with fire weather. It's been very moderate. But I know every one of you have been seeing the smoke, potentially smelling the smoke. And that's a reminder of the work that we are doing right now. I'm trying to look at the bright side of the smoke. The smoke is all coming from Northern California from lightning fires. And I did reach out to a friend of mine and just wanted to ask the question, said, based on the moderate fire weather that we've been having, these fires are a series of lightning fires that happened almost a month ago. Are they low intensity and perhaps beneficial fires? And so again, trying to look at the bright side. So maybe that these fires are actually doing some good for the environment. And he says, at this time, yes, they are low intensity and beneficial. However, the concern that we always have in California is almost any fire is one bad weather day from a community. That's their continues to be their concern, but at least for now, the smoke that we are seeing is at least from beneficial fire. Did want to point out that September 17th, 1923 was the ignition date of Marin's largest fire that burned from Novato into Bolinas. That same night, the first Oakland Hills, or at least what we consider the first Oakland Hills fire burned, what we consider the first Hanley fire burned. Did Hanley fire burn again in 64, burned again in 17, and also the Nuns fire burned that same night. So the whole thing where we talk about the best way to predict the future is look at the past. At the time in 1923, Woodacre had 35 homes. 30 of those homes were destroyed in Woodacre. I meant to pull up how many homes are in Woodacre before the meeting, didn't have time, but I can guarantee you there's at least a zero added to that 35. So just look at the devastation that we could have had. And while we are enjoying cooler temperatures right now, the sun is coming up later, setting earlier, we're having a smaller, what we call a burn window. Just know that we are entering the fall weather pattern. And the fall weather pattern means we'll have a low pressure system come in. We're going to feel nice and cool, moist, and then an offshore wind event. Most of them will be mild to moderate, and some of them could be strong. And that is that offshore or that fall weather pattern. And those of you who are watching fire weather, you probably noticed that Northern California and a little bit to the east did have red flag warnings for low humidity, not for wind, but for low for humidity. And if you can consider that we were able to reach low humidity with the temperatures that we had, that means it was an extremely dry air mass. And that dry air mass is what is going to continue to push fires. So long way of saying we need to continue our vigilance. We're not out of fire season yet. Yesterday I did, or actually 2 days ago, I did have an opportunity to present at the Wildfire Mitigation Advisory Committee. It's a committee that is hosted by Cal Fire and has wildfire practitioners as well as industry professionals connected to that committee. And they really wanted to learn more about the MWPA. We gave a presentation that went very well, was well received, and could help us continue to grow our network as far as funding opportunities, but also was able to make some key contacts specifically with PG&E as well to help with our alignment with our work with between MWPA and PG&E. Yesterday, I did have an opportunity to participate in the Marin Conservation League's discussion on insurance. They had two primary speakers. One was a former general counsel for the California Department of Insurance. He spent 8 years working for CDI. And the other was a very intelligent young lady working for Milliman. It's an actuarial for the insurance companies and reinsurance. Fascinating discussion. I will say that the gentleman from the CDI, super intelligent. And obviously, if you're going to be general counsel for a state organization like that, you must have some skills. But his mom may or may not be listening right now. So I would attribute his intelligence to his mom right now. So Bell Cole's son. But What I appreciated was the alignment of his views on how we can work through this problem is very much in alignment with the direction that we're going, with the partnerships that we're trying to create to solve the insurance crisis that's developing in California, and which was in alignment with Milliman's views, which is in alignment with the on-the-ground work and partnerships that we have going. So I feel like we are going in the right direction with that. Our resident grant program is very successful right now. In fact, I anticipate we'll be through the budgeted amount of money sometime in October to November. One keynote I wanted to bring up, though, is the stat that's up here. You see that we have funded $365,000 of our money, or MWPA money, has gone to the residents. But the residents who have applied for those grants have spent $2.9 million. So that means every dollar that MWPA is spending, the residents are spending $8. And so I see this as a double return on investment, the return on investment to the taxpayers who are getting the grant to support their work there, and the community members that they live next to are receiving a return on their investment. But then the MWPA is getting a return on our investment because we're putting in $1 and getting $8 worth of work towards the overall mission. We are like the staff's recommendation. Well, once we exhaust those funds, is to not ask for more funding for the grant program, because while it's successful, many of our member agencies and staff agrees it's not as targeted as it needs to be. And we need to start setting criteria that we are dealing with the most riskiest elements in the DSpace and home hardening world first. And then if people have taken care of the riskiest stuff, then they can start getting grants for the not so risky. An example I'll give is replacing windows that really have no vegetation below them, and that window really is not a threat, while they still have vents that are a threat. So we can start setting up prioritizations. Hey, if you want windows, you got to get vents done first. We are really close. We're on the home stretch of the evacuation ingress egress risk assessment. The technical advisory team has been reviewing the report and the GIS data behind it. We have received fantastic feedback. We have two or three more meetings with our TAT members to continue to receive that feedback. We intend to bring the assessment to the executive committee in October and then to the full board in October. President McMillan came across a fantastic article, and I can help share the link. And it was research that was done across the nation. Where should the U.S. spend money on wildfire mitigation work? And in alignment with what I was talking about with our grants, that we want to make sure that we're spending our money at the best place possible to mitigate risk. This study looked at areas within the country that would reduce wildfire-caused carbon emissions. They also looked at where it's going to protect human communities. So if you see the light blue dots, that's where the carbon loss was valuable. And where you see the dark blue, that's where there's protected communities. If you look at the yellow and if you squint really, really tight, you'll see that Marin is yellow. That means that we have both the carbon loss benefit and the human lives benefit. So we really are doing what we should be doing, where we're doing it. So, and it's being recognized that we are one of the areas that should be doing the type of work that we are doing. Two different evacuation discussions I want to talk about. One of them I shared with you all, and that was the email discussion we had with an Inverness resident who asked fantastic questions, and we had a great dialogue back and forth. It was suggested that we turn that into a op-ed, shared it through the Point Reyes Light. Sounds like the community received it very well. We do want to find broader ways to share that as well. We might not be able to get it in other newspapers because newspapers tend to not want to run op-eds that were run in another newspaper, but it was our product. We'll be able to push it out through FireSafe Marin, through our website, so on and so forth, which we will. About the same time I was having that email conversation, we did the FireSafe Marin panel discussion that lasted about an hour, facilitated by Rich Shortall, Jason Weber, Todd Lowno, myself participated in it. It is up on FireSafe Marin's YouTube channel. We'll get a link onto it for on our website, but we're getting a lot of great feedback on that. I hope that we were able to put the right context to what occurred in Maui, is that it is a wake-up call, can happen anywhere, but there are differences between Marin and Maui, and these are what the differences are. And finally, at our next board meeting, I anticipate to introduce to you our two new vegetation management specialists and a grant specialist. And with that, I'll stop the screen share and take any questions.
Board members, questions for our executive officer, Catherine.
Going back to the insurance issue, we were talking about the need for a broader group of policies, I mean, to widen the area in order to even be qualified. Did that come up in this discussion?
Yes. Basically spreading the risk for the insurance.
That's what I meant.
Exactly. Yeah, for sure that conversation did come up.
Bruce.
Hi, Mark. This isn't a question, comment. Really great report. Thank you. I did want to make a comment on regarding where we spend money and, you know, the carbon and, you know, the human resource issues. Here in Marin, I think the board should be aware, and I spoke this before, but there are a few new board members that the Governor's Office of Planning and Research granted the Marin RCD $500,000, $500,000 to take a look at the biomass movement, movement of biomass. Associated with our work and all of our partners' work, currently where it's coming from, where it's currently going, and then to look to maybe optimize it to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, improve employment and ecological implications. But it what the my point is that part of this project is Chapter C is evaluating the greenhouse gas effects that we're having with the work that we're doing, the benefits basically. But the exciting thing is that we have a group called Spatial Informatics is they're analyzing what our greenhouse gas would be emissions would be in a life cycle, let's say 60 years, 80 years, without our treatment in the event of the inevitable ignition, that you're talking about, what the fires would look like without treatment, and then taking a look at what the fires would be because of our treatment. And it's called avoided wildfire emissions, but it is a greenhouse gas calculation, and it's intent on quantifying the greenhouse gas life cycle, greenhouse gas benefits associated with hazard mitigation work here, with an attempt to likely bring it into the voluntary carbon market. And so that we can actually cash in on not just the health, public health benefits, public safety benefits, but the greenhouse gas benefits associated with that. So I'll keep you all posted. I'm excited about it. I'm in awe, AWE, avoided wildfire emissions.
Hi, this is Mark White. I have a comment.
Go ahead, Mark.
I just want to say,
a question. We'll take comments after we open it up to the public.
Okay.
Okay, we'll get back to you.
Yeah, just briefly, I don't know if I'm out of order, but Mark, I wasn't going to pull anything from the consent, but 6B, the software, can I ask about that? Or should we save that for later? I was just curious, you know, it wasn't in the report and it's in the consent, but I was curious about the status of the licenses and, you know, kind of the work that's going on with the, you know, with the SAS and Active Fire.
I think we'll wait
for that.
Yeah, thank you. Anybody else? I have one question about the setting of priorities about grant money. Who is going to do that and how are they going to be trained to do that? That seems really complicated.
Excellent question. And we will be, and when our new grant specialist comes on board and we exhaust the current grant funds, that will be the grant specialist's primary mission, is to retool the grant program to work around priorities. And we're going to identify those priorities through two primary mechanisms, using our subject matter experts from each of our member agencies. So the member agencies will be the ones that are setting the priorities, not the MWPA staff, but that priority decision making will be supported by our work that we've been doing with Willow Labs, where we have been modeling the fire risk. Well, a better way to put it is that we've been modeling the hazards that are on the property and the risks that they create, so that we are removing the proper hazards.
Okay, great. Thank you. Any other questions from the board? All right, let's open it up to the public. Public comment on this item, Martina.
If there are any members of the public wishing to speak on the executive officer's oral report, please raise your hand in the reactions. And for those joining us by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand and *6 to unmute yourself. And President McMillan, there are no hands for public comment, but it does look like Director White has something to say.
Yes, Director White, go ahead.
Thank you, Julie. Just want to say on behalf of Chief Perry and the Stinson Beach Fire Protection District, I want to thank everyone who attended our field trip along the northern edge of Stinson Beach to view the shaded fuel break last week. We also want to thank Andrew Osten and the All-Star Tree Company and the TAM Fire Crew and Fire Foundry for their diligence in this work. And we just want to really thank everyone for coming. We're sorry we didn't get many people from Stinson, but everyone in town is really proud of the fire break, and we hope someday we can do some more. So thank you all very much.
It was a beautiful day out there. Thank you for hosting us.
Oh, pleasure. I didn't bring lemonade.
Any other comments from board members? I did want to thank Mark for attending our age-friendly Ross event at the Cedars last week and giving great remarks and calming down our older residents about fire preparedness. So thank you. Number 6, consent. The opportunity for public comment on consent calendar items will occur prior to the board's discussion of the consent calendar. The board may approve the entire consent calendar with one action. In the alternative, items on the consent calendar may be removed by any board or staff member for separate discussion and vote. I will now take public comment on the consent calendar.
If there are any members of the public wishing to speak on the consent calendar item only, please raise your hand in the reactions. And for those joining us by phone, please press star 9 to raise your hand or star 6 to unmute yourself. And there are no hands for public comment.
Great. Do any board members wish to remove an item from the consent calendar?
Yeah, I didn't want to remove 6B, but maybe Mark, if you can possibly next executive report, next meeting, say a little bit. I find the program really important and interesting, and you know, some of the details in the amendment. It was, you know, only a license fee increase, but it'd be great to get an update on that if that's possible.
I can give you a real brief update if you're good with it.
Yes, go ahead.
Sure. So what we did was we transferred from SurveyMonkey providing our platform for our grants program to FireAside. The reason why we did that was twofold. It increases, it improves the resident experience through it. And instead of having to go through one platform to get to another platform, it is all in one platform now. And then the data mining that we can do through FireAside is far better through FireAside than we can through SurveyMonkey. We're actually already on the platform. They built the platform for us. We were able to use it before we evaluated it. And then they kept us at the same subscription costs as SurveyMonkey was. And the reason why we needed, normally a $14,000 transaction would not need to come to the board. But when you do the cumulative of the two subscriptions that we've had previously with FireAside, it gets to the $150,000 threshold of cumulative that we needed to bring it to the board.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Since no items have been pulled, I will now entertain a motion to approve the consent calendar.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Motion by Director Kohler, second by Director Polson. Martina, can you please take the roll?
Certainly. Starting with Bolinas, Director Molesworth.
Yes.
For Mill Valley, Director Burke.
Yes.
For Larkspur, Director Polson.
Yes.
For the County of Marin, Director Rodoni.
Yes.
For Inverness, Director Donahue.
Yes.
For Kenfield, Director Evergettis.
Aye.
For Marinwood, Director Shea.
Aye.
For Muir Beach, Director Murray.
Aye.
For Novato, Director Goings.
Aye.
For Sleepy Hollow, Director Finn.
Aye.
For Southern Marin Fire, Director Hilliard.
Aye.
For Stinson Beach Fire, Director White.
Aye.
For the Town of Corte Madera, Director Casisa.
Aye.
For the Town of Fairfax, Director Kohler.
Aye.
For the Town of San Anselmo, Director Feynman.
Aye.
And President McMillan for the Town of Ross.
Aye.
Motion carries with the unanimous vote of all in attendance.
Thank you, Martina. Number 7, staff reports. A, Treasurer Alyssa Schiffman will provide the board with a staff report for this item.
Actually, I'll cover that one today.
Oh, thank you, Mark.
Yeah, and as the staff report mentions that we are 21% through the fiscal year, we've met 7% of the budget. That's typical because we have to do a little bit of ramp up before we start doing the core spending. Administrative costs and the core costs are tracking like they have in the past few years. Again, we only have a couple months of data right now for this fiscal year. And just wanted to know that in 9 days, we will be getting the end of year closeout information from our member agencies. And we're currently scheduling a finance committee meeting for the close of our books. And so that we can transfer or roll over any money that we need over to this current fiscal year. And we'll bring that to the board at the October meeting.
Questions for Mark about the treasurer report? Catherine.
So Mark, I'm looking at the report in general, and I noticed that we have legal bills for the last 2 months that amount to about $275,000, which is, according, if I multiply that times 6, because that's, you know, 2 months out of, well, maybe it's wrong. But I'm thinking it's getting us close to about $1.7 million a year. Is that what we anticipated in our budget for legal expenses?
No. What I'm looking at, we've only spent $11,825 for legal services.
I got this out of the report. Sorry.
Maybe
it was in the section that shows what checks have been written. in the past 2 months? Is that different from what we're showing in the budget itself? Yeah.
It could be from previous fiscal year.
Okay. Well, anyway, that's just my question is, how are we doing? What is the burn rate per month, generally speaking, on how much money are we burning per month on legal fees usually? Or maybe that you have to calculate that.
No, actually the amount that we have here for $11,000 through 2+ months is about what we've been going through.
Okay, thanks. All right.
Any other questions? Public comment on this item, Martina?
If there are any members of the public wishing to speak on the current agenda item 7A, the September 2023 MWPA finance report, please raise your hand in the reactions. And for those joining us by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand and *6 to unmute yourself. And there are no hands for comment.
All right, let's bring this back to the board for any further discussion. Mark, I would suggest that you and Catherine figure out, the 275
issue. Yeah, I'm scanning right now.
Thank you. Anybody else have any comments? All right. B, fiscal year 2022-23 work plan implementation update. Planning and Program Manager Ann Quilock will provide the board with a staff report for this item.
Great, thank you. I'll just go through a few slides that are photo heavy, so not too dense here. As Director White mentioned, we held a field trip in Stinson Beach, and this was really to highlight some of the work happening at the northern edge of town on federal land. So this was a great example of another partnership with GGNRA, who have been fantastic partners on this project, and in fact helped write the project description and the treatment plan for this work, which included reduction of cover of non-native Pride of Madeira, which was very thick, very woody, and would have been a lot of fuel in this area. This was a great field trip on September 12th and had a good time out there in the field with beautiful scenery and a lot of happy, smiling folks. It was a really good, good field trip. So thank you everyone who took part in this. We'd like to have additional field trips in the coastal zone in the future. We also hosted another field trip on August 29th, and this is for the San Rafael San Anselmo Fuel Reduction Zone project. In the previous PowerPoint in August, I showed a map, so I decided to show pictures this time. We had a really good turnout, maybe 30 or 40 folks attended, including one of our county supervisors, several board members. Again, thank you for attending. We had San Rafael Fire and Ross Valley Fire, Ecologically Sound Practices Partnership, and a lot of residents who live in the project area or live directly adjacent to the project area and are very appreciative of this project. Just as a reminder, this is a project that is not yet approved and hasn't finished the environmental compliance process. We're going through the CalVTP for our project-specific analysis and addendum, so you'll see that on the board agenda in the next few months, we think this winter. And this involves thinning of eucalyptus trees, the small diameter eucalyptus trees, rather than the large eucalyptus you're seeing in this photo. But it should reduce fire hazard to San Anselmo and San Rafael. And as you can see, there are thousands and thousands of stems in this project area. So our chipper program is still going strong. We've seen a big increase in activity this year and expect that to continue. Stephen Peters has done a fantastic job of managing this process and this program and resident inquiries. It's scheduled to continue through mid-November. Our grant program has been slowed a little bit through the loss of our grant specialist, but we're very excited to have a new grant specialist start as early as September 25th. So stay tuned for more reports in that. And I just wanted to end with a couple of photos. We've got a lot of activity going on in Novato, on the Greater Novato Shaded Fuel Break. This is a before and after of work taking place within that project area. The agenda and the staff report includes a table including some updates on acres and miles treated in the last month since August. And as we move forward with our GIS program development, we'll have more and more accurate numbers to share with you. But for now, those are all ballpark numbers. And then this is a photo taken today along Olema Road in the Greater Ross Valley Shaded Field Break. Just a really lovely example of reducing dense broom understory and reducing risk to potentially evacuating residents. And I'll leave it there. Any questions?
Thank you, Anne. Questions, Barbara?
Yeah, thank you, Anne. I just want to comment on Olema Road. That's right across the street from me, and I've walked that with a couple of the MWPA guys, and I know what it looked like before. So the picture that you have before is not as outstanding as what it really looked like. It was a mess. But a question on the GGNRA. You said they've been great partners. Mm-hmm. And refresh my memory, do they ever provide any funding?
They are really spread thin in terms of funding and staff right now for work throughout their region. Greg Jones has been working with us as much as he possibly can, and I think he's trying to staff up a little bit. So far, we have been using Measure C funding for projects like this, but I think there are opportunities in the future for additional kind of partnerships in that arena. But for now, I know they're spread very thin, and a lot of this work would not take place at all without Measure C in place.
Well, I know the feds are also looking at cutting federal firefighter pay rates. I just think, I think you're doing great work. I think MWPA is doing great work. It's important work, but I think we really need to get our foot in the door there and really start asking them to start providing some sort of match. And you can start out small, but they're going to continue to get a free ride here. And I think should MWPA go away in the future, we want them to be able to start doing this because they haven't been doing it on any of their federal lands at all. So I just think I know we have a great partnership and I appreciate that, but I really do think we need to start asking them to provide even a small match so that they have more skin in the game. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And I would just add, you know, in terms of match, it might be worth considering staff time, not just for, you know, their fire ecologists that we work with regularly, but also the team that has to then, there's a process internally when we would like to work on federal land. And we go through the process of proposing a project, co-writing the project description, and then they have an entire team that has to review it. So it's several staff members. It's not funding, but it is at least several staff members on their end.
Well, I think you can always say, try to quantify the in-kind, but I really do think, I know I'm harping on this, we really need to start getting them to do a little more. And I think it can be incremental, but you know, the feds need to start ponying up on all their federal lands, not just the few that we're working on. Thanks.
If I could provide it, that's a great segue to actually Danny Franco's presentation this afternoon and the Forest Health Strategy. And included in the Forest Health Strategy is Chapter 8 and the projects they're proposing. And using that Forest Health Strategy and Chapter 8 to go after federal funds is part of that strategy, and also being able to use it for not only NPS funds, but also other federal or state grants. So we do see it's not, there's light at the end of the tunnel for increased federal funding. I can't guarantee it, but there is light at the end of the tunnel.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Stephen.
Is Pride of Madera highly flammable?
I would characterize it as it would have significant heat coming from it, and there is a fair amount of dead material related to it that would get the live material going, and that's where the heat would come from.
It's exploded in our town and in my neighborhood over the last 5 years. And it's very clever because it puts itself on embankments that people don't look at or treat in their property, mm-hmm. but it gets really big, really fast.
It does.
So if we could somehow educate and talk to our fire departments to educate people on how to maintain and remove that, I think that would be great. Because people love it because it flowers and it grows really fast. But if it's dangerous, we should do something about it. So thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Pride of Madeira.
Is that the same thing as Echium?
Yes, it's the same.
Great.
It grows in dense stands, sometimes 8-10 feet tall with a lot of woody material.
Yeah, the Stinson Beach. Yeah, mm-hmm. The Stinson Beach fire chief characterized it as Echium. Mm-hmm. Another question? Yeah. Barry, did you have a question? No. Okay, Gabe.
Yeah. Thanks. And I was wondering, you know, maybe you can just tell me where this is on the web, but, you know, we're kind of doing the measure of how many miles of the Ross Valley shaded fuel break, and in this case, the Novato shaded fuel break are done. And is that posted, or can you just give me those numbers?
Sure. Let me see if I can pull them up. They should be in the table that's attached to the staff report at this point. And I know for the greater Ross Valley shaded fuel break, we're at around 19 or 20 miles. And for Novato, I think Novato may have been measuring acres. So that's part of our kind of data collection standardization process that we're working on, and that the Green Info Network will help us. So Greater Novato Shaded Fuel Break is at about 62.4 acres. So I don't have miles for that, but I can take a look and get that back to you. You know, one of the things that Novato has been doing is working within some of the polygons that aren't necessarily linear within that project area. So,
thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Yes, Fred.
Yeah, thanks for the report. Do you have any other field trips scheduled or coming up? Because I know I attended, but I attended both Serenfell and Stinson Beach. I found those to be extremely beneficial because you can actually see the work that's being done. And you can really relate to it. I know there's a number of the members from public that were there also. I just think they're great and they're beneficial. I just wondering if you had any more scheduled or coming up.
I'm so glad you asked that question. Yes, we are looking for another date and location for a field trip, hopefully as soon as October. We are one of the locations we're looking at, I've mentioned this before, but it's going back to the Greater Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break and some of the areas that were treated previously and just taking a look to see how they're looking now, even though they weren't treated this year necessarily. But we've had some other suggestions too. So we're currently looking at kind of the logistics of different locations and parking and safety and accessibility. Mm-hmm. So yes, stay tuned. I will make sure to let you guys all know.
Gabe.
Sorry, I had one more follow-up question. I was wondering what the coordination with the county was. You know, I talked to Max Court, and then apparently some of the Measure A money was being used for Bald Hill and San Anselmo. And, you know, how is that working for, you know, total coverage of the Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break or complementary coverage?
Yeah, that's a great question. We are working closely with Marin County Parks and Open Space staff, and they are implementing portions of the Greater Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break through Measure A. And so that's a great benefit. And then Marin County Fire is also going to be implementing portions of the project through their own grant funding as well. So we're able to take advantage of our partners to expand our footprint. We've also seen some residents reach out to our contractors to do additional work outside of the project footprint on their own. That's all extremely helpful. This is very expensive work, and we are using our CAL FIRE grant. So we appreciate all the extra help from additional partners.
Thank you.
Catherine.
Have you taken a look at Southern Marin lately?
Would you like a field trip in Southern Marin?
I think we have a grant, maybe not yet, but okay. in a few months. You could do that. That'd be great.
Yes, I'd love to do that.
Martina, public comment on this item?
If there are any members of the public who would like to speak on the current agenda item, 7B, the fiscal year 22-23 work plan implementation update. Please raise your hand in the reactions. And for those joining us by phone, please press star 9 to raise your hand and star 6 to unmute yourself. And there are no hands for comment.
All right. We'll bring this back to the board for any further discussion. Anybody? All right. Letter 6, outreach funding and governmental affairs update. Mark Brown and Bill Keene will provide the staff report on this item. Welcome, Bill.
I'll kick it off and then pass it off to Bill. Just like any other organization, especially when it comes to making connections with other governmental entities and or private partners, there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes. And so we felt it was time to let you guys know a lot of the work that's going on behind the scenes, creating connections with, well, one of the big connections we want is with funding agencies so that we can continue to get more money to do the work that we're doing. Also connecting so that when policy decisions are made, they're made in a way that supports the work that we're doing. And then also we've been doing a little bit more work on outreach, making sure the public knows exactly what we're doing. And I'll just, before I kick it off, Bill, I'll give one quick example of a success. And our invite to Tuesday's Wildfire Advisory Committee meeting occurred because of inviting CAL FIRE representation to see what their grant money was doing here in the Greater Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break. And when they saw our work, they said, we need you to come share this story at our advisory committee. That gets us to the advisory committee, and that gets us to get even more connections. So we think it's working, and Bill's going to give some examples of where it's really digging in.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Mark. Can you all hear me? Okay, great. I think it's been probably a year and a half since I've presented in front of you, and I'm excited to be here, and hopefully you're excited about the topics I cover today. So there's four areas I want to cover: outreach, funding, governmental affairs, and then also some other things that I've been involved in support of MWPA. So starting with outreach, some of you may know about the Wildfire and Forest Resilience Task Force, but that's a statewide task force that is controlling better part of $15 billion. And some of your grant funding, actually a lot of your grant funding, has come through that. I do attend and maintain contact with members on the task force, both the executive committee, but also key funders. I'll talk a little more about that later in the funding part. But a couple of things I wanted to say: the work that we've done with the task force, the MWPA was to able to table at the Santa Cruz meeting, and then we also had one of the tours for the Santa Cruz meeting, which I helped set up for you, and that was a great way to showcase the work of the Greater Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break to attendees of the task force, but also some of the funders came along and were there as well. There's an organization in the state called the Department of Conservation, and they run a program called the Regional Forest and Fire Capacity Program. We've been involved in reviewing their guidelines, influencing that program, and most recently, and I'm sad to say it didn't make it through the legislature this session, but AB 388, put forward by Connolly, was going to move us toward those block grants that we've talked about in the past. Didn't quite get over the finish line. It got really close. And we're hopeful. We've been told by Connolly's office that we can work with them next year and see how we might either be able to introduce something similar to that or any other legislation that this organization is interested in pushing through. And then I did want to mention OneTAM. I think one of the directors talked about that. OneTAM's part of, includes the Golden Gate Conservancy and federal lands. You'll hear about the, Chapter 8, which is the regional priority plan. That is a component that gets you eligible for this regional forest and fire capacity program, which we're looking for block grants down the road. CNRA, or the California Natural Resources Agency, this is something that I track on your behalf. A lot of the grant funding opportunities that I'll talk about later come through just being engaged. And your staff is busy here doing the work, and I'm able to sort of track things in Sacramento to help avail you of opportunities. And I'll talk a little bit about that later. CNRA includes a couple of the agencies we've worked with. the Coastal Conservancy and the Department of Conservation, which I just mentioned, fall under CNRA. The Center for Western Weather and Water Extremes, this is an organization that's based out of Scripps Institute of Oceanography. If you've heard about atmospheric rivers, I think we all have based on last winter's rains, the center is the main expert on weather extremes, and including atmospheric rivers. We've been connected through some of my previous work with the center, and I'll say a little bit more about one grant opportunity that we just submitted in, but we're looking to get some new tools that will help us manage our work during the work season, the non-fire season, and better refine how we're able to start that work and do it. These tools will help support that. But I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute. We also have a Drought Smart, Fire Smart partnership with North Bay Watershed Association. We're currently in our phase one of this, and this is really drought and fire landscaping is very similar. And the idea of marketing it together makes sense. And so I was able to get us connected with North Bay Watershed Association to make that a reality. MMWD, we have some new board members on Marin Water, and I was able to connect Mark with a couple of them, including Matt Sampson. Matt Sampson represents Northern San Rafael, and he is heavily involved in the fire prevention for Marin Water, very interested. And I think that connection with Mark was super helpful. It also helped get us connected for this grant, which I'll talk about that we went after with NOAA. It also connected us with the watershed manager for that works and manages the watershed, Sean Horn. I want to say a little bit about tours. You heard about a couple of tours. We did three over the last year, and I apologize to Bruce Goins in advance for the first one because I think he has a lingering injury from that one. But when we were, I shouldn't be laughing. When Mark and I have been interacting in some of these task force meetings, there's the Department of Conservation, and it turns out a couple of them, Mark and I have mountain biked here and there, and a couple of them, and we said, hey, come over and look at some of our work in Marin. And then it turned up, well, yeah, we'd like to come over. And then other people heard about it. And pretty soon we had a party in Marin on bikes, looking at the early part of the Ross Valley shaded fuel break work, but also really looking at the work at Tamarancho along Iron Springs Road. And we did it by bike, which was a little challenging. But that was the first of our tours. And then we did two this year, one with the Wildfire Task Force, and we did that also on the Greater Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break. And then we did another one for our CAL FIRE funders, the ones who run the programs that have gotten us all this money for the Shaded Fuel Breaks. They were out there, and we got great feedback. And I'll show some pictures. I did want to highlight on the CAL FIRE tour, one of the grazers was out there, and we were able to connect with her and hear about some of the challenges. And Mark's been able to work on some issues related to the grazing. Here's just some pictures of our first, or really our second tour, our first tour this year with the task force. We actually had a sunny day. For our state agency funders tours, we picked the only bad day of the summer, I think, with rain, possible rain. We didn't get rained on, fortunately. This is on Triple C Ranch here on the left. You can see, if you get a chance to go to top of Manor Road and look at Triple C and what they've done, it's pretty amazing. This little box here, you can kind of see fuzzily some white things out in the distance. Well, that's actually the grazing herd, and the grazer was out there, and we were able to see it firsthand what's happening out on Triple C. And there's a picture of all this. Director Rodoni was out there, and we had a couple other board members from the Board of Supervisors, Katie Rice and Mary Sackett. So let's talk a little bit about funding. I mentioned this NOAA grant. We just put in a grant. It's part of the federal infrastructure bill, and this is something I brought to Mark's attention. It's a challenge grant, and we've put in with Public Works, Marin Water, and One Tam. A $19.2 million proposal. which builds on the forest health strategy, which you'll hear about from Danny in a bit. But I did want to mention the two things we covered. We have the phase two for the ingress egress risk assessment is included, and then this work with the Center for Western Weather and Water Extremes. By the way, this presentation is available. I think Martina's already archived it on the website. So if you want to see these slides, I'm not going to go over all of this, but essentially what CW3E can develop is a tool that will help us predict when the fire season ends. And so that's the first part of it's a model that they can develop. And we're looking for funding for that. A second piece that they can do is they can develop a tool, and these are things they've done for Southern California Edison too, a tool that will help us better predict the wind patterns. So I think you talked about the Hanley fire and these major fires that have these huge wind events. They have an ability to develop a tool that will help us forecast what those fires winds would be like and where they would be. And then the egress study is really extending the toolkit that will help develop the preventative projects in the high-risk zone. We also put in for $3 million recently for the Integrated Climate Adaptation Resiliency Program. This is ICARP. It's run out of the Governor's Office of Planning and Research. We've got $3 million in for the Greater Nevada Shaded Fuel Break. Coastal Conservancy, in the interest of time, we've been involved in discussions with them for a long time. We did put one proposal in that didn't get funded, and it was for the ingress egress study. Although I do believe City of Mill Valley got funded for some work in that same submittal. But we did connect Fire Foundry with the Coastal Conservancy. And I'm really excited that Fire Foundry is going to enter into an agreement with the Conservancy for training funds, for PPE for all of their members, and for actual project funding. I don't know the exact amount. What we were talking about early on was, you know, 300,000 range, but that's a lot of money for Fire Foundry. And I'm really excited to see them connect with the Coastal Conservancy. And it meets the Coastal Conservancy's strategic plan on equity, which we pointed out to them and actually made comments on their strategic plan. So I'm really excited to see them do that. You'll hear about the Forest Health Grant, the CAL FIRE one, probably from Danny today. We didn't get that one. We did submit, but you know, I can't just talk about the positive ones. I also gotta at least let you know. Sometimes we don't get funded, but we did get funded for two grants. One, the Ross Valley Shaded Fuel Break for $3.25 million, and then the Novato Shaded Fuel Break for $2.6 million. And I think we've already heard that money is being spent wisely and quickly. A little on governmental affairs, AB 388, this would have created block grants. I'm not going to spend any time on it other than we did our best to try to push this over the finish line. Didn't quite get there. And then there are two climate bonds that have significant funding in it for wildfire and forest resilience and climate resiliency. They are now two-year bills. We have been supportive of that, putting in letters, talking to legislators, and there'll be more work to do next year in the next legislative session. And my hope is that these will go. I think there's a darn good chance that they'll go. And they're part of a larger climate package that has stuff for water and other things. So I do think that there's a good chance in that you'll see it on the ballot in November 2024. And then lastly, I think of myself as an extension of staff. This is an example. This is a good example of that. We had a state water board tour, and I know staff were buried. So I took on really organizing a tour that helped to showcase the mitigation measures that the projects that MWPA is doing to protect waterways. And that's something that I know Ann's been heavily involved in, along with the consultant that does for Panorama. And we were able to showcase all of this stuff. And I have to say the state board staff who are out there were quite impressed. They're seeing that the Cal VTP is working, which is great news, because it turns out I don't think we need permit streamlining and CEQA streamlining. It's working just fine. And I think the work that MWPA really demonstrated that. One other area, a couple other areas, just real quickly. Folks might remember Doug McConnell from Bay Area Backroads fame. He also had a second show called Open Road. We just learned that they're getting their 10th season from NBC Bay Area. And we've been working with Doug and his team to look at the possibility of creating an episode on Open Road. If not an episode, some vignette videos, but I'm hoping an Open Road episode where it showcases the great work that MWPA is doing with its residents and to protect our houses that are right adjacent to the Wui area. And then lastly, I love working with Jean Bonander. I don't get enough chance to do that, but with her and Phil Hallstein, we've done 2 staff retreats, co-planned and co-created them, where we're really helping to integrate the staff's work into the strategic plan and what your board wants to see and improve the work processes that they have at MWPA. And with that, happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Bell. That's all excellent. Questions from the board? Gabe.
Yeah, Bill, first, I just want to thank you. I remember 2 years ago or before we met, and a lot of this was just, you know, not even hatched. Really high level question. I don't know if this is, but generally when you go for grant money, what are you finding are the best selling points of MWPA? Because we have so many things going on.
You know, I think one of the best selling points is what you've already done. I mean, early on it was maybe a little tougher because you hadn't done the work yet and you were still getting your sea legs. But I think when we go out and show them the work, they're blown away. Like if we can get them out, sometimes it's hard to get them out. Like it's just, they're cemented in Sacramento. So that's one thing. The other thing that I think is really compelling is whether you really think about this very much or not, this is the only one of its kind in the country. Like we don't realize this, maybe we do, but like this is special. This organization is special. This funding is special. I used to work for Sonoma Open Space, and it was one of the only publicly funded land conservation agencies, and I managed that for 12 years. And I knew it was special, but there was a whole history before I got there. You guys are creating and building the model for the state and the nation. I mean, that's really what it is. And people are starting to take note of that, and it's going to attract money. I mean, you're already seeing, look at the small amount of money you put into the grant funding program for residents. Yields $3 million. That's amazing. That's a 8-to-1 return. That's phenomenal. And I see that growing. And I see out in my, I live in Fairfax and I'm on Forest Avenue. I'm right in that area that might burn. And I can tell you that the residents love the chipper program. It is it's not a ton of money and they love it. And they see the work. They see the crews that are coming out doing the inspections. And I mean, it's just an easy sell, frankly.
Great. Thank you. Anybody else? Public comment, Martina, on this item? Oh, I'm sorry, Bruce.
Hi, Bill. Thanks for your work. It's really phenomenal. And without your presence, I think we'd have a difficult time, you know, making those connections and building the relationships. You mentioned AB 388. And that there was an attempt to put together the ability for entities to apply for state funds, a block grant, which in essence, you know, grants the entity the ability to apply it to whatever projects they, you know, that are fit in time. Can you, I don't know if, you know, folks really comprehend the difference between block grant and what the current, but the pitch that we now have to make is, can you just be clear that without a block grant, what kind of a pitch do we need to make? And I know we're going to talk about the regional forest health strategy, but can you just talk about the nuances, why block grant would have been great and how it compares to what the current situation is in order to be successful in getting funds?
So the big difference is, think of it as economy of scales, right? Like right now we apply for 10 different grants and each of them is $1 million. And each one of those is a significant effort. And under a block grant, we got the same 10 projects under one grant, and we're getting the $10 million in a block grant. And I mean, that just saves a ton of time for your grant writer, well, in grant reporting, and I mean, you're not tracking 10 different grants. So the ability to do that, and I actually think this is a benefit to CAL FIRE and the state agencies. They'll have to manage less grants and they'll spend the money quicker.
And why did that not succeed in the legislature?
I think there was some opposition from CAL FIRE to it, but they got too comfortable with it. So I'm not totally sure. I mean, that's something I know Mark and I are going to be meeting with Connolly's staff and think about how to resurrect this somehow, but also try to better understand. Because from what I was hearing towards the end, it was going to make it. Yeah. And it just at the last minute just didn't get over the finish line.
Okay. Barbara.
Yeah, I sit on a legislative committee and we just met with Damon, and I've also talked to him privately. Some of what happens is he's brand new and they don't like people to have as many successes. So, but if you want that to happen, you got to get on it in January. That's when the 2-year bills come back, and that's when they come back. So may or may not happen. And he's done a great job for his first year. He came out of the gate and got 7 bills to the governor's desk. We don't know how many of those will be signed. So that's a real success rate. So I think he's doing a good job partnering with people. And anyway, January, get on it. Thank you very much, Bill.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Alexis?
I'm sorry if I missed this at another point, but how much money is brought in through grants each year, and how has that changed? The reason I ask is partly because I think it's important to be communicating out, like the 8-to-1. It's important to communicate out to taxpayers that, you know, we're really leveraging the money that's being collected and taking it far.
Mark.
Yeah, I'll touch on that. And every time we do receive a grant, we've been pushing out a press release. And then the 2 largest grants we received are the CAL FIRE grants, 3.25, 2.6. In partnership with Novato Fire and Conservation Bay, Corps North Bay, $400,000, and then a allocation from Assemblymember Levine to Southern Marin Fire for $900,000, and then in partnership with Marin RCD, the $400,000-$500,000 for the biomass study. Thank you.
It might be good to have a place on the website where we just kind of add all those up and have a brief explanation.
Yeah.
Great. Yes, Barbara.
Just one follow-up question based on Alexis's question. You know how you talked about our resident grant program, for every dollar we spend, they're spending about $8. Are you doing the same thing when you talk about the grants that MWPA has been successful? I think that will also resonate with the voters, that for our 20 million or so, we brought in this much and how we're leveraging that. And that also feeds into what Anne was talking about, is in kind. So we're probably not there yet, but I think you were going to speak to that, Mark. Thank you.
Yeah, that's and I see two sides of that as well. The return on investment for the taxpayers, but then we also get to go look at and tell CAL FIRE, hey, look, you gave us $3.25 million, but look at how much we put into it. So there is both those returns on investments, and we are, especially when we have web pages that are still hidden right now for our strategic measures, grants being one of them. And in that web page, that's where we're going to be able to share that story. We just haven't lit them up yet.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Bruce.
Hi. Just one more comment. Bill, I know that you're aware that we are, and it's a question, that we did complete a strategic plan for MWPA, and the question of what speaks to funding entities. And this is, one is that I'm assuming that you're aware of the content and the intended that we're looking at objectives and metrics and monitoring. And so my question is, and I've always thought that it's critical not just to say that we want to do this the following project this coming year, but we're able to articulate the magnitude of the problem ahead of us and what we envision as success, which is that's the denominator, that's the bottom of the formula, like how many acres we really need to treat as opposed to, you know, 100 acres here or 1,000 acres here or whatever. But so what are your thoughts on the value of us being able to articulate that full extent of the issue that what we see as success and what increments we're asking them to fund, as opposed to just saying, hey, we got a project here, we got a project there, you know, Greater Ross Valley, Greater Novato, but there's a much bigger area that needs to be treated to be able to say that we need to treat, you know, 500,000 acres, and this will help us get. Anyway, I'm going to stop there. I think it's a question you can understand.
I'm glad you asked that question, and I'm sure Mark will add to this too. But the short answer is there's a lot ahead. It's like the best way to describe it to me, like, is we've built this much of the bridge, and there's this huge bridge we got to build to get across to the other side, to the promised land, which is wildfire resiliency, right? And I think being able to quantify what's left so that you're demonstrating, first of all, you're going to have the metrics that I know Charlotte Jourdain's been working on, that shows here's what we've gotten for the money, but we still have this enormous unmet need. And it helps you on two fronts. I think it's going to help you go after grant funding, because you're going to say, we're not done. We're not even close to done. And we can't do it without your help, because it's an enormous amount of money that you're not collecting in the tax. The other thing it does, I think, is it, as you slowly make progress, is you're going to demonstrate to your tax base, the people who are paying it, here's what we've done with your money. And then at year eight, you're going to go to the voters and say, what do you think? We're halfway there. We're a third of the way there. And then we all know this. It's sort of a little like the maintenance part is like painting the Golden Gate Bridge. It's never done. Yeah. Right. So there's always going to be a need for that.
Yeah. And all I'll say is that the federal and state granting agencies have expressed a little bit of frustration of agencies who have received grants not being able to show a return on investment. And not just matching, saying, hey, we had a 25% match, we had a 10% match. They actually want to be able to see the return on investment and a reduction of risk. And we're likely to be the first agency to come and say, okay, here's the risk we reduced.
Great. Anyone else? Yes, Catherine.
I'd just like to say what it's doing for us in terms of public outreach. First of all the great work that's going on with publicity, but in our area, people are seeing and feeling and receiving grants, and I'm getting input as a board member. And it's the success is, you know, it's not just Southern Marin, it's also MWPA. People are seeing, okay, the question came up at our last board meeting, who are we as Southern Marin reaching within our jurisdiction to let them know what we're doing? And the answer came back that between the MWPA grant programs and what we're doing with Shredders and, you know, working with Mill Valley, we're almost reaching 100%. There are people, they're very much aware of it. So it's not just the work that we're doing as MWPA, it's also helping us as the individual agencies. So I just wanted to add that.
Great, thank you. Martina, can we take public comment on this item?
If there are any members of the public wishing to speak on the current item 7C, Outreach Funding and Governmental Affairs Update, please raise your hand in the reactions. And for those joining us by phone, please press star 9 to raise your hand and star 6 to unmute yourself. Star 6 to raise your hand and star 9 to unmute yourself. And there are no hands for public comment.
Thank you. Let's bring it back to the board for any final comments or discussion. We kind of had discussion during questions. Any final thoughts? Great. Thank you. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you all for the opportunity to work with you.
Great job. Item 8, committee reports. First is Fire Safe Marin, Rich Shortall.
Mark or somebody, you need to free up my video if you don't mind for one sec. Sorry. The host has stopped it. Did we catch that?
Patience.
Hello?
Yeah, they're working on it, Rich.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Sorry about that.
Go for it, Rich.
Wonderful. Great. Thanks very much. Appreciate the opportunity as always. For once, we're a little bit ahead of schedule. I usually come on at the very end, and I haven't actually reviewed one of the reports for a long time. If you don't mind, I'd like to take just a couple of minutes to go through it very quickly. Of course, you all have it, but there are a few highlights that I'd like to bring up here. First of all, I hope everybody can see that. Let me know if you can't. The report always begins with sort of an executive summary, but there's some numbers that I want to pull out of that. The Adapt to Wildfire program, that's our big outreach campaign, and it's the one that goes out in a lot of formats and a lot of different places. So we're up to about 3 million views just in the last 4 to 6 weeks. We have a new resource library on the website that I really encourage you to take a look at. It's a big change. We're really kind of proud of it. And a lot of the materials that were created are now easily available and downloadable. So I think it's a real upgrade to what we have there. The Community Ambassador Program, which is really reaching out in person to engage people, whether it be at tabling events, fairs, you name it, that we've reached, when we wrote this, it was about 4,600 residents. We're rapidly approaching 5,000 residents. And that's just in the last few months. So we're really out there in public, face-to-face, engaging people. And the feedback we're getting from that has been really, really positive. We're excited about that. We've put together some new materials. We'll talk about those in a minute. And I'll just start scooting through this real quickly here a little bit. A lot of you hopefully were able to see the Wildfire Watch TV special that we did right after the tragic event in Maui. I want to thank Mark, was really great on that. But if you haven't watched it, go to the YouTube channel and check it out. We had about 500 people that night, and we're now over 1,000 people who've viewed it retroactively. But we really covered a lot of interesting material, and everybody who saw it has gotten back with really positive outreach. And I think it's also a testament to the type of leadership we have in Marin and the fire agencies and whatnot to be able to pull something together like this and speak so knowledgeably about it for the public. Social media is a big deal for us. It keeps growing. So just in August, 151 posts. We have a person who's pretty busy doing this all the time. See it 70,000 times out there. The ever popular Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. I personally am not really big on that stuff, but it is actually worth checking it out. So you can see in this is what some of it looks like, but there's a lot of material going out on that. We get a lot of reaction to it. This just tells you, this is a big thing to that. We're getting into the website now. So not surprisingly, because of Maui, we had 19,000 visitors to the website in August. We're usually looking at about 12,000. And that's people who actually visited, but they spent a lot of time on it doing different things. A lot of views on the YouTube channel, almost 10,000 of them. Newsletter goes out, high open rate. We keep getting new subscribers to that. And of course, a lot of social media posts. So we're really out there in a lot of different platforms, but we remain very proud of the website. That still is sort of the flagship of the organization. And again, check out the resource library on that. This gives you an idea. You can see all the campaigns and all the components that we've done that for Adapt to Wildfire, articles that we've done, all the brochures, guides, maps that we create are all on there, easy to find, easy to download. Everything we do is really amplified by community partners. And I think this speaks well to Marin County, where we just have a very cooperative environment here. So we work with a lot of different people, including folks like the California Fire Safe Council. We regularly attend meetings with them, so we kind of know what's going on throughout the state. Enjoy a very good reputation there. But these are all the different groups that we work with, that we interact with every month out there, and it gives you a little idea of the types of things we are doing with all of them. It's a pretty broad representation. So once again, besides just working with a website, doing social media, face-to-face engagement, we engage firsthand with a lot of important groups here in Marin. The ADAPT campaign is very popular. As I say, I won't spend a lot of time on it, but Evacuation was the theme a few weeks ago. Most of these campaigns last about 5 weeks. Now we're on a slow to spread the fire. And you can sort of see how the campaign evolves depending on what the theme is that's out there. Everything that we do pretty much now is in Spanish and English. We're almost 100% bilingual in all that we do. We're pretty proud of that. FireWise USA is going along very well. We have a new leadership there. So we're kind of excited about that. We're really going top to bottom through all the sites that are out there to make sure everybody's in good stead. And we're about to start the renewal process, which is due in November, which is kind of a big deal. We don't usually talk about it, but we get a ton of phone and email inquiries. Every single day, I talk to two or three residents that have made phone calls to us, just following up on whatever their question is. And then we get a lot of informational emails. A lot of them were able to handle a lot of this material, which saves the fire departments and whatnot from having to engage with it. But we really do, at the end of the year, you'll see, we really do a lot of this. We're always making new educational materials. Everybody is loving this. We call it a postcard because it's about, I think it's like 6x5 or 7x5, something like that. But it's kind of catchy with a nice picture about when you survive a wildfire. And then it gives you the 5 big action steps that you need to take to do that. People really are enjoying this. It's easy to digest. These are all the type of educational materials that we put out there. We still support the Dispensable Space Program. This is a lot more detail on that Community Ambassador Program. Gives you an idea of what some of these engagements, where we're going, some of the things that we're doing out there. And then the last thing is the peer-to-peer project that we're working with San Rafael Fire Department. We have all the materials ready for that. We're in the recruitment phase of that and hopefully get it launched pretty soon. So with that, I would be glad to answer any questions. I just have one final comment, sorry, and that is our annual report, which is really comprehensive. And this will be for everything we did in the last fiscal year. We're a little behind it, but we will have it done by the end of the month. And so that will really capture literally 12 months of hard work and investment in public education in Marin County. So again, with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Rich. Questions from the board. Dennis.
Yeah. Thank you, Rich, for the report. I'm wondering, with this Spanish translation being available, whether you're able to track how many contacts you're getting specifically in the Spanish language.
So if it's a face-to-face contact, we're going to be starting to track this with the new programs we're doing, because we're going to be doing trainings and other outreach 100% in Spanish for some parts of it. So that's to come. That's the in-person. We know that about 12 or 15% of the material that we're putting out online is targeted and going to browsers that are set in Spanish. So that's sort of a percentage of all those millions of views that are going out there. And then when we, although we don't track the exact numbers, we've been engaging at the food banks for the last couple of months. We've done quite a bit with that. You know, we don't ask people what language they speak. We have materials in both. We kind of stop people in their cars. And I would say we're probably, depending on which one it is, it's probably 60 or 70% of the people who are participating, typically around 275, 300 at each event, that are mostly, if they're not speaking English, mostly Spanish language. That's sort of a snapshot of what it looks like.
Thank you, Rich.
Anybody else? Okay, Martina, can we open it up to the public, please?
If there are any members of the public wishing to speak on the current agenda item, 8A, the Fire Safe Marin Report for September 2023. Please raise your hand in the reactions or press *6 to raise your hand and *9 to unmute yourself if you're joining us by phone. And there are no hands for comment.
All right, bringing it back to the board. Any final comments? Rich, I just want to say that I've been attending the FireWise leader meetings monthly because I'm a FireWise leader and I always learn a lot. And I do want to thank you for talking to our age-friendly Ross residents last Wednesday with Mark. and particularly last night to the town of Ross and our FireWise neighborhood group as well. You and Miranda did a great job. So thank you.
Thank you. Much appreciated.
All right. Number nine, the big item. The presentation on the forest health strategy. Danny Franco, is he going to be online?
I'm bringing him over and making sure up here. He's coming,
but just down the hall.
Unfortunately, he had to be in the city today, so he will be presenting remotely with us today. But before we really kick it off to Danny, all I want to say is that Danny is a fantastic partner. Very much enjoy working with him, and every bit of work that he does it with the eye of collaboration.
Wonderful. Welcome, Danny. We're excited to hear your report. Uh-oh, you seem to be muted.
You'd think after however many years of Zoom it's been, I would have figured out how to unmute myself, but here we are. Good afternoon. Thanks for having me. And thanks, Mark, for the introduction. The feeling is definitely mutual. I know I don't have much time today, so I'm just gonna jump right in and try to share my slides. I hope to leave ample time for questions. Let me know if that looks clear on your end.
It looks great. Thank you.
Great. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. Here we go. I didn't know I was the big item, by the way. Thank you. the Marin Regional Forest Health Strategy. My name is Danny Franco. I'm a senior project manager with the Golden Gate National Parks Conservancy. We're the nonprofit support member of the One TAM Collaborative. I've been with the organization for 13 years now. And this project, this initiative, has been a real privilege and a treat to lead on behalf of the collaborative. If you don't know, just very quickly, a little background on One TAM. We were established in 2014. The collaborative builds on the unique talents and strengths of each partner agency. Each of these land managing agencies, you know, manages a piece of Mount Tamalpais, right? The literal and figurative heart of Marin County. The partnership provides a platform to work collaboratively across jurisdictional boundaries for the benefit of community and the environment. The Forest Health Strategy was developed over a three-year process by the One TAM Partnership in collaboration with the Federated Indians of Grattan Rancheria. That's our federally recognized tribe in Marin County. The Marin Wildfire Prevention Authority, you may have heard of them. A team of consultants and a panel of scientific and technical reviewers. So a three-year process, which means that I'm just going to cram as much information as I can into the remaining 9 minutes that I have. I do want to just acknowledge, though, the contributions that Bruce Goins, Mark Brown, and Ann Creelock made to this collaborative effort, this strategic plan. They participated in workshop meetings. They reviewed the extent, 1,000-page strategic plan and provided feedback and recommendations. So I just, I just want to echo or kind of reciprocate, Mark, what you said in your introduction of just how great, Anne, Mark, and Bruce, you have been in terms of collaborators. It's deeply appreciated. Okay, so this might be preaching to the choir a little bit, but I feel like I have to kind of give you some background on why we care about forests in Marin County. Forests and the natural processes that take place within them provide benefits for all living creatures. Stop, right? We need forests. Marin County has at least 24 distinct forest types, including conifers like coast redwood and Douglas fir, oak woodland, grassland savannas, evergreen hardwood forests like Pacific madrone, and even fire-dependent species like bishop pine. Forest ecosystems provide habitat for wildlife, bats, salmon, northern spotted owls, much more. 3/4 of Marin's water comes from the heavily forested Mount Tamalpais watershed. Without healthy and resilient forests, Marin's water quality and quantity is vulnerable to threats like extreme wildfire, erosion, and sedimentation. Trees breathe in carbon dioxide, which is a greenhouse gas that traps heat and contributes to climate change. Trees breathe out oxygen that we need. Forests store carbon in their biomass, which can get released in the event of a high severity wildfire, which then adds more carbon dioxide to the air. The forested parklands and protected open spaces in Marin provide people with opportunities to get outdoors and exercise, activities healthy for the body and mind. These areas also draw millions of visitors to Marin each year, which generates revenue for our local governments and businesses and creates jobs. This is important. The ecological health and long-term resilience of forests and woodlands in Marin are already being impacted by plant disease, introduced weeds, present and past land use, fire exclusion, the legacy of colonization, climate change, and hazardous wildfire. Trees and forests take care of us. We need to take care of them. That's why we did this forest health strategy. Okay, so a little bit about our process, right? Or what we did in this forest health strategy. Again, 1,000-page document. I know you're all going to go home and read it after this, but let me boil it down for you. We developed goals for the health and resilience of 5 key forest types to protect or enhance ecosystem services. I just went over a bunch of those: clean water, carbon sequestration, wildlife habitat. We used something called the Marin Countywide Fine Scale Vegetation Map as the basic unit of analysis to identify the distribution of key forest types across the county. This is important. I'll come back to it. This is a great slide. These are all the vegetation communities in Marin County. This is the distribution of the 5 key forest types that we studied. We quantified and located threats to forest health and resilience using metrics from this veg map and from other data. Again, we're working at landscape scale here, people, right? This is remote sensing so that we can work at scale. We created a framework to identify priority projects and various treatment approaches. And we describe methods for monitoring treatment outcomes and landscape changes. That part I know is important to you, Bruce. Okay, so just some additional information on our process, right? So the distribution has implications for management, so it's fun to talk about, right? Pathogen impacts, right? So mortality from things like sudden oak death or drought. This builds on sort of mapping that had already been done on the water district previously in 2008 and 2014. What I'm showing you here is that there is mortality in all of the forest types that we studied. The impacts of fire exclusion and fire history, right? So this provides valuable context for understanding the current conditions and potential management approaches. What this shows, by the way, this is really cool. So this is the number of times that we've had fire in Marin County between 1859 and 2020, right? You can see that there's some areas there that are more prone to having fire, that you can probably trace your fuel breaks like somewhere along their edges, right? This is the fire return interval between 1859 and 1940, right? So sort of the period before modern fire suppression really kind of took off. And you can see that there are, you know, fire return intervals in those high fire return interval severity areas, you know, those areas where we have more regular fire happening on the landscape, you know, in some places every 5 to 15 years, in other places 15 to 30 years, right? Here's the time since last fire, right? We haven't had a fire in most of the high fire prone areas in over 70 years. This is the slide I know that Mark and Bruce care about. We looked at stand structure, right? So the composition of forested stands, not just what type of forest it is, but how much of it is hardwood, how much of it is conifer, right? We looked at, we used LIDAR to create structural classes that's helpful for approximating the age of different forest types. Like how old are those, and what's the structure of those Bishop Pines that have come up since the 95 Vision Fire? You know, where are our old growth or old growth like redwood stands? This is really important information that we've uncovered through the forest health strategy. We created, used LIDAR to create ladder fuels, right? So we know that ladder fuels are important metric in understanding and predicting fire behavior, right? We mapped that out. And we looked at changes in the density of canopy over time to look for pockets of drought stress trees on the landscape. We also developed a suite of prioritization layers, and I just want to underscore real quick that, you know, all of this analysis is done at the countywide scale with the intention of supporting the work of MWPA as well as all of the OneTAM partners, right? So we did this at the countywide scale with intention of collaboration with the MWPA. So we synthesized all of the sort of metrics that give us clues into where there are stressed pockets of forest on the landscape into a single layer that's easily digestible. That's called the Departures from Desired Condition Index. It looks something like this. We classified wildfire hazard. So we worked with some really savvy GIS folks who are doing similar wildfire hazard and risk mapping around the Bay Area. Sonoma, Santa Cruz, Santa Clara, Alameda, Contra Costa are all using this same workflow to really get at a kind of a comprehensive model of where we have wildfire hazard on the landscape in the county. We looked at classified building density. Again, this is really useful for understanding in a fine scale manner, where are the areas of wooey, right? You're starting to see that the idea is to overlap areas where we have degraded forest conditions with high density, high building density, so that we can nail down where those treatment areas need to be. Here's a great example of someplace called San Geronimo Valley. We did this treatment feasibility raster. I just looked at this with Bruce a couple weeks ago. You know, this stratifies the landscape into areas where mechanical or manual work is more or less feasible, right? This helps us prioritize that landscape scale, that watershed scale. And this is what that looks like. I swear it's useful. It's a lot of data, I know. Okay, so here's some fun facts. There are 118,000 acres of forest and woodland in Marin County, equivalent to an area of 184 square miles. That's if you took a paintbrush and painted all of City County, San Francisco, four times over with trees. Forests cover over one third of all of Marin County. The OneTAM partners manage 51% of those forests, right? All native forests, 60,000 acres of native forest in Marin are managed by OneTAM. This means that we have a responsibility and also an opportunity to address threats to forest health and increase forest resilience at the landscape scale. And when we talk about forest resilience, we're talking about wildfire resilience. They are connected, right? Forest types and conditions are not uniform across protected areas. So collaboration is really the key to maximizing the impact of our collective work. What I'm highlighting here is just showing you that, you know, National Park Service and Marin Water account for, you know, 62% of the conifer forests in the county, right? So these are protected conifer forests in the county are managed mostly by Marin Water and the National Park Service. But if you look down here at deciduous and evergreen hardwoods, the bulk of the protected hardwood forests and woodlands are actually on county lands. So it's only through collaboration that we can really get resilience across this diverse suite of forest types that we have in the county. Okay, key findings. I'm going to just blow through these. This is a big one. How am I doing on time? Good?
Yeah.
Keep going?
Yeah, we're all involved.
You're all here. Okay, you're still here. I can't see you. So everyone could have left the room and already been down at the bar and I wouldn't know. Fire exclusion produces changes in the, so fire exclusion, right? When we say fire exclusion, we mean both the removal of indigenous burning from the landscape through the process of colonization, right? So the cessation or interruption of Coast Miwok burning. And we also mean fire suppression, right? The putting out of naturally occurring wildfires. So fire exclusion produces changes in the fuel structure, forest structure, and floristic composition of all of our forests, frankly, in the county. And we've demonstrated that in this document. Fire is a super important driver for structural and floristic heterogeneity. That means biodiversity, right? We need fire because that disturbance creates heterogeneity, right? The opposite of a monoculture is diversity. And in the absence of fire, we're getting all sorts of changes in the forests that are not good for wildfire behavior, and they're not good for biodiversity. The overall trend in Marin, and this is what we know this intuitively, but our forest health strategy really underscores this. The overall trend in Marin is one of increasing fire return interval and decreasing wildfire extent, right? So fire return intervals increase dramatically. That's the time between fires, increased dramatically between 1860 and 1990s, rising from approximately every 10 years to more than every 38 years. That's scary.
Yeah.
Concurrently, the average acres burned per year has significantly decreased, right? So increasing time between fires, and when fires do happen, they're smaller and smaller and smaller. The average acres burned per year has decreased from on an average 1% of the total county area, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it is. And between 1852 and 1900 to since 1960, just 0.1% of the county has experienced good fire since 1960. It should be noted that the fire return intervals prior to colonization, right? So this record search, that we worked with Arthur Dawson to create only goes back to 1860 because that's when we have Euro-American record keeping. And some areas may have experienced more frequent fire as a result of Coast Miwok stewardship with fire. But there are, fire return is complex, right? There are places along the coast where it would be normal to not have a fire for 100 years, right? So that's the caveat that that the fire ecologist wanted to make sure I put on this slide. Okay, I'm going to talk about sudden oak death really quickly and other diseases, right? So Phytophthora morum, that sudden oak death, first documented in the U.S. in Marin County, right, on Marin water and state park lands in 95. Vegetation mapping that sort of precedes the work that we did as part of the forest health strategy started tracking that information and found that over 90% of oak woodlands within the study area, that's Mount Tam, were affected by the disease with 84% of forested lands, right? So sudden oak death is everywhere, especially in Marin County. So we confirmed that with our work that mortality and pathogen impacts were detected across all the key forest types. We found a substantial portion of native forests had detectable mortality in their canopy, right? 13,000 acres, that's clearly an underestimate because we can only see from a bird's eye view where there's mortality. We know there's mortality in the understory too. This analysis, again, this is what I just said, is limited to the detectable mortality within the forest canopy. The takeaway message here is that sudden oak death impacts are real and they are widespread. Okay, weeds. This is something that Ann Krelock knows a lot about. I will say that, caveat, right? We didn't have the data to do a robust, presence-absence analysis of invasive species across the entire county, but we do have some really useful data to share, right? And one of the things that we know through the forest health strategy is that the ability of non-native invasive species to reduce biological diversity and degrade habitat joins with evidence that some types like eucalyptus can contribute to fuel conditions associated with hazardous wildfire. This makes a compelling case for active management. You all are already doing that. We need to do more of it to protect and increase forest resilience and ecological function wherever we can. This is just some raw metrics, right? We've got 2,100 acres of eucalyptus in the county. We've got another 1,400 acres of just general non-native forest, myoporum, pittosporum. There are a lot of weedy trees and shrubs out there, and they are a fire risk, as well as a risk to biodiversity, right? This is really important. Successful invasive plant management requires the use of integrated pest management strategies that leverage every tool in the toolbox. We need to make sure that our land managers have access to all of the IPM strategies so that we can successfully deal with invasive plants in the county. OneTAM has several initiatives. I'd love to talk to you more about them some other time. Early detection rapid response program, it's really great. And our invasive plant monitoring and management program. This is my last slide, I swear. Next steps, we are going to continue to try and work with the tribe. The tribe has to be an integral part of bringing good fire back to the land, of bringing stewardship back to the land. This is a space where we can all do better. I'm really proud that we worked with the tribe on the forest health strategy, but that's just a first step. We need to keep engaging with the tribe. The OneTAM partners are going to continue to work to advance opportunities to fundraise for, plan, develop, implement projects across the county. I heard Bill's presentation. We're doing the same thing. We're collaborating on grants like that NOAA grant with MWPA. We're in the same boat of having to go after competitive grants because that, block grant funding wasn't realized. So it's CAL FIRE, WCB, Coastal Conservancy, everybody, right? We're going after these funds and we're using this forest health strategy to do so. And then lastly, because I know this is an important one, and I might get questions from someone named Bruce Goins, we are going to continue to collaborate on strengthening data collection and evaluation of forest health as part of our projects, right? Field-based inventories, community science initiatives. We have some of those in place already. That's like Marin Wildfire Watch, which is our camera trap program. We have a rare plant monitoring program. We have a bat monitoring program. In addition, we want to collaborate with MWPA on coordinated countywide treatment tracking. That's a recommendation in the forest health strategy. It's right up front in the executive summary. We need to use that to be able to measure project outcomes and inform future management. And with that, I will stop and take questions.
Wow. Thank you, Danny. That's really incredible and so impressive. Questions from the board? I have a couple questions. I'm wondering who paid for the study?
Thanks. That's a really good question. I took that slide out for time, so I'm glad you asked it. So funding for the forest health strategy comes from the California Department of Natural Resources Regional Forest and Fire Capacity Program, which is managed by the Department of Conservation. So in 2019-2020, the Department of Conservation rolled out this program, and it's great. In fact, the block program, the block grant program that Bill described earlier, was really geared towards a second round of funding for those regions like Marin that have gone through the Regional Forest and Fire Capacity Program to develop a regional plan like the Forest Health Strategy. And then we're supposed to get access to block grant funding to then implement priority projects identified in our strategic plan. That block grant didn't happen, so we're going to have to go after individual projects. But it's the Regional Forest and Fire Capacity Program that has been so powerful and instrumental. The California State Coastal Conservancy got a block grant from that initial chunk of Regional Forest and Fire Capacity Program fundings in 2019-2020. And OneTAM is a subgrantee of the Coastal Conservancy. And so we took $750,000 from the Coastal Conservancy and developed this plan over 3 years.
Just seems to me like the MWPA is a huge beneficiary of this study. So maybe we should showcase that. I'm also wondering how you're going to communicate all of this to the public, because it's really complicated and nuanced. And the one thing that stood out to me was the map where you had frequency of fires. And then the next map was the fact that there were have been virtually no fires in 70 years. And that's kind of a terrifying juxtaposition. And I'm just wondering how, I mean, that will help us with our work to communicate that to the public. And I'm wondering what your plan is to get this out.
Right. So we have been getting the word out sort of We can walk and chew gum over at OneTAM. So we have been having lots of public engagement throughout the process, right? You know, meetings with MCL, meetings and hikes with MCL, with the, you know, Audubon folks, meetings and hikes with CMPS, meetings and hikes with neighbors. We plan to do some additional workshops, and I can make sure I get those links to Mark, and maybe we can do some cross-posting, right, on social medias and things like that. For all the grants that we're putting in, we are putting in for additional engagement funding so that we can do more hikes, workshops, things that are open to the public, right? We'd love to co-present on workshops with MWPA, especially around the impacts of fire exclusion and the need to get good fire back on the landscape. That is something that if we're going to do it in Marin County, is really going to take collaboration between the MWPA and the land managing agencies, right? But it really needs to happen. I'm going to put a link into the chat for this really cool self-guided tour that we did. So Marin Water has been doing some forest resilience work, as some of you may know, around Lake Lagunitas to protect their critical water storage infrastructure there. And so through this forest health strategy work and OneTAM, we developed a kind of self-guided tour. You can print it at home. It's an 11 by 17 map that, you know, guides you around and interprets some of the forestry work that you're seeing there. We have a mobile trailhead at OneTAM. It's called the TAM van. It looks like a taco truck, but instead they hand out, you know, stickers and tattoos to kids and give information and do interpretation. We had a huge stack of these self-guided tours for the forestry work on Mount Tam. And I mean, they've just been blowing through them, right? So it's sort of an all hands approach when it comes to engagement, but we'd love to partner with the MWP on any of and all of the above.
Any other questions? Public comment, Martina?
If there are any members of the public wishing to speak on the current agenda item, the presentation on forest health strategy, please raise your hand in the reactions. And if you're joining us by phone, please press *6 to raise your hand and *9 to unmute yourself. And there are no hands for comments.
Any final comments from the board? I'm Bruce. Yes, Bruce.
Danny, I just want to say in my 50 years as a forester, you know, I've seen some phenomenal, you know, analytical work and partnerships and collaboration. But this is really a treasure, you know, what you've done and, you know, pulling together the principal landowners, those who manage that land, who are responsible for that land. One of the most difficult things is out year planning. It's to identify that which is critical, and that's what you want to commit to. This appears to me to be like the roadmap for individual, you know, the five major OneTAM partners, or maybe it's six, to then dig into this and look at their polygons, their footprint, and see, you know, how the polygons that you have identified align with their interests and needs. And also, I just see this being a starting point, cornerstone, if you will, maybe an opportunity acceleration of restoration activities. And I just want to tell you, I hold this project in the highest regard, and I want to thank you personally for your dedication, for your amazing work. I want to thank you so much.
Yeah, Catherine.
I think this is terrific. And because it was so much so fast, and I don't think it was included in the packet, but I know that it's online. Can you just tell us the link? How do we get to your summary, what you showed just now?
Yep. One. I'll just give you a copy of the slides. If that's okay, I can email them to Mark or whomever, and those can be distributed. And you guys can use those slides and repackage them as well. I know that Mark and Bill are out giving presentations all the time. But you can also just access the report as well as summaries of the report on the OneTAM website at onetam.org.
Right.
It's all public. The maps, the data. The public really needs to see this, and they need our help in understanding it.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much for trying to distill it down. I'm only on page 400.
Wow. That's pretty good. I'm impressed.
I'm a slow reader. All right.
And you thought I loved my job. How about how much Danny loves his job?
Yeah. So impressive. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thanks for the invitation. Thank you, Bruce, for the kind words. And I look forward to partnering with MWPA on into the future.
Likewise. Thank you.
Thank you, Danny.
Item B, we're just going to acknowledge the minutes from the August 23rd, 2023 Citizens Oversight Committee meeting. Number 10, board members' request regarding future agenda items. Do any board members have requests for future items? I'm going to turn it over to Bruce Goines for a second before we adjourn.
Hi. Let's see. This will only take a moment, but I think you all recall that we had planned to thank Dennis Rodoni for his year of phenomenal service as president of MWPA. And I can tell you, you know, having done this for a couple of years, there how much time and work goes on behind the scenes. And Dennis, with his busy schedule, county supervisor, president of the board, county supervisor seats, is a phenomenal asset. I mean, he kept me on track. He kind of had my back for the presidency. I attempted to have his back during his term in presidency, but I think it's important to, you know, we didn't go to McNear Beach, didn't see any plaques, didn't see any ribbons or anything. And I think this is at Dennis's request that, you know, he's a humble man, he's a public servant, he works his tail off. But so something that I've done professionally, being with the United States Forest Service, you're all familiar with Smokey the Bear. I have a Smokey the Bear pin that I don't know if I want to pin Dennis because he's probably going to punch me, but this is something I've given in Brazil, in Washington, D.C., in several states. People just do phenomenal public service related to forest health, you know, public health and safety. And Dennis, I just want to say thank you for your service, and I want to see this on you one of these soon meetings, okay? So anyway, Smokey loves you.
Thank you.
And there will be plaques and ribbons soon to come.
Thank you all. I appreciate it. Thanks, Bruce.
Thank you. All right. We're going to adjourn the meeting, and I will see you all at the board meeting on October 19th. Thank you.